While we work out our technology issues, welcome to PM Zagreb March, I guess, is our fixed meetup. Our speaker is Radan here. He will be discussing Agile and Friends for us. I just wanted to remind you first, please go on the Facebook group because we're posting lots of articles there that will help you throughout your day and week. And also, I will post a link for Joined In so that you can actually rate this talk. Why should you rate this talk? Well, it will help him get accepted to other conferences. So please go on the Facebook group. Again, that link is on the meetup page. So I think we're
Yeah, just a second.
And also, please put your phone on silent. We'll actually record this talk and we will put it on YouTube so you can watch it later in case you miss anything. And you can also share it with your colleagues. Let's welcome Radan.
Thank you everyone for coming. Today I want to talk about Agile and Friends. By Agile I mean the Agile methodology. But before I actually get to Agile, I want to take a little trip in history and talk about how before, decades ago, the standard way of developing software was the so-called waterfall method. And the one of the key concepts in the waterfall method was big requirements up front. And that's a document that's supposed to, the idea is that before you start working on a project, you're gonna list all of the requirements, absolutely everything to the smallest detail about how the software should function. And from there, you proceed in some distinct phases where first you have the requirements phase, it's gathering requirements, talking to the customers. Then you go to the design phase where everything is designed, every screen of the application is designed. Then you go to the implementation where the developers are actually doing some work. And you go to verification where you're checking that everything was built according to the original big requirements up front document. And then you just go into this maintenance. Other than the maintenance just being kind of fuzzy here because everything goes on in maintenance. There is another very, very big problem with this approach. Would somebody want to take a guess?
Changes.
Yes. Thank you. It's change. And if you want to be more precise, it's unexpected change. If you want to be even more precise, the worst kind is unexpected late change. Now, the following scenario might sound a bit familiar. You work on a software and you've got a version ready for review and you bring up a test server and you send it over to the clients and the clients come back with a great way to improve the application and the only thing you have to change is almost everything. That is going to be awesome. Or even worse, you send it over and the client comes back saying, you know, this is great, but this is not what we had in mind. We can't use this. This does not solve our problem. And if you experience that or something similar, you're not alone. In fact, in 2001 in Snowbird in Utah, there was a gathering of 17 software development experts who gathered together to figure out the problem because they and ski and drink, but figure out the problem because they experienced similar problems and they found solutions and they wanted to see if there are anything common in those solutions. And actually, they all practiced various ways of developing software. And actually, all of those ways are what we today refer to as the Agile methodologies. So it's a bit funny because all the methodologies that we call Agile are actually older than the Agile term itself. And the reason is that 2001 and Snowbird, they managed to come up with a common ground between all of the methodologies, and they decided to call it the Agile Manifesto. It's available, it's very easy to remember URL, and it actually contains just the manifesto. And the manifesto is actually very short, so I think it makes sense to go to the manifesto right now and kind of talk about what it means. So the manifesto starts by saying, we are uncovering better ways of developing software by doing it and helping others do it. The important thing here is that the emphasis is on uncovering rather than thinking up a way of doing it. So they're drawing on their experience on real-world examples. It's not an academic, it wasn't an academic exercise. Everything was done through trial and error and seeing what worked and what didn't work. Through this work, we have come to value individuals and interactions over processes and tools. This value, for me at least, it boils down to the fact that humans develop software, not robots, humans. This seems obvious, but it's often forgotten, and one of the ways it's forgotten is that it shows is that in our industry and in a lot of companies, developers are referred to as development resources. Something that's pluggable and interchangeable that you can just shift from one project to the other. You know, just like a factory line. You know, let's have this factory also produce this part. And actually, humans have some certain desires and the way they function where that needs to be catered to. They need to understand what they're doing. They need to understand why they're doing it. And that's how they function most efficiently. And processes are more about sending things, drawing them all over the wall. The next value is working software over comprehensive documentation. The purpose of every document, documenting the behavior of the software, is to communicate what the software is supposed to do. And the most direct way of communicating that is the software itself. All of the ambiguity is removed if you can actually use the software. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation is the third value. And the point here is that if you collaboration works to increase the value, negotiation works to protect the parties involved. And if you look at it that way, it becomes clear that in order to increase the value in the world at large, we need to collaborate. We're going to create much more value if we're collaborating than if we're protecting our own assets. The last value is responding to change over following a plan. There is a certain period of time from when the plan is made until you get to actually implement the plan. And a lot of things can change in the meantime. It can change in the world. You can find out new things. And if the change that you find out about will significantly increase the value of the software, then it doesn't make sense to stick to the plan, because you could be spending days, weeks, months working on something which has absolutely no value. And who benefits from that? Literally nobody. And the manifesto ends with, then as while there is value in the items on the right, we value the items on the left more. Now, some kind of process, some amount of documentation, some kind of contract, and some kind of plan is of course useful. The problem is when it goes overboard, when you go too much on it, when you try to rely completely on it. And the right amount is the amount that's just the amount, the minimum amount that is needed to support the values on the left to function properly. So that's the Agile Manifesto. And now I wanna go over one of the Agile methodologies, and it's probably the most popular one. It's called SCRUM. The basic unit in SCRUM is the sprint, and the sprint is a time-boxed effort within which we aim to deliver the next iteration of the software. And the sprint starts with sprint planning, where we take the product backlog. Oh, this is broken. Okay. I should have tested better. Okay. So, sprint planning goes here, this goes here, just use your imagination. So sprint planning starts with looking at the product backlog, and product backlog is usually composed of high-level user stories, where you describe how a feature in a way that the user is going to use it. The team sits down together with a product owner who is really a representative of the stakeholders. He is able to make decisions on behalf of stakeholders, and the Scrum Master, who is here really a facilitator, enabling that everything goes smoothly. And they talk about which backlog items they want to take in. That's the first phase, and it's a time-bound phase. The next phase is the team sits down and then breaks down all of the items into actual tickets that can be implemented and estimates the tickets. And then it goes into sprint and tries to implement all of those tickets. At the end of the sprint, a sprint review is first performed, where working software that was implemented is presented to the client. And the emphasis is here on working software. So only the stuff that are finished, that are actually working, are presented. And the client then gives feedback, and maybe some suggestions can be made to the product backlog based on what was done there. After that, the team goes into the retrospective, where they look at what went well and what went not so well in the sprint and discuss how they can improve. And there are some more nuances here, but this is most of Scrum. If you can understand this, then you understand most of Scrum. Now, I think it's interesting to look at what Scrum does, how Scrum is implemented, how that relates back to the Agile values. So first we had individuals and interactions over processes and tools. And Scrum does that by having everyone sit down and creating a sprint. So you don't have laborious documents and detailed processes where you just follow a process. You sit down, you bring everybody who needs to be there in one place, and you sit down and you talk it over. You discuss it and you figure out what you want to build. The next one is working software over comprehensive documentation, and it does that quite literally by having working software at the end of the sprint. That is the main output. So you actually show working software which should be deployable to production at that moment. Then the next one is customer collaboration over contract negotiation. And it does that by having customers involved in between sprints. So during sprint review, the customer gives feedback, and the feedback is taken into account when planning the next sprint. And the customer talks about how what you build could be improved and what would be the most valuable thing to deliver in the next sprint. And the last value was responding to change or following a plan. And it does that by allowing the product backlog to be changed for the next sprint, in between sprints. So however long your sprint is, that is the frequency at which you can accept change. So if you have a 2-week sprint, every 2 weeks you are open to having change, any change in the product backlog. And I think the last one, the responding to change, is maybe the most important value in Agile. So let's have a look at that one in particular, and let's see how we can go from values to principles. So we start with the last value, responding to change or following a plan. So we're welcoming change. Okay, now that we are welcoming change, it would be good that we discover the need for it as early as possible, so that we can make the best possible effort, prepare the best we can for it. And because there are many occasions where you could discover change, some of them might go unused, you also want to remove ambiguity. So that once you enable the change to be discovered, you want to remove ambiguity so there's absolutely no chance that you're going to miss it. And the easiest way to do that is to show working software often. So we start with a value, and we end up with a very specific Scrum principle. And with all of the Agile methodologies, if you go and read about them, try and do an exercise where you try and trace it back to the values. And for most of them, you can actually trace it back to the values. And if you plot out the plot, it actually becomes clearer why you're doing that. It's not just an arbitrary practice that somebody said you need to do. There is a very specific reason for that. So that's about Scrum. I'm only going to mention some of the other Agile methodologies because there's not enough time to go over them. One very popular is Kanban. It actually has roots in Toyota. Toyota Lean system that they developed in the 50s and the 60s, so it's very, very old. Kanban is the name when the Lean system was taken and adapted to software development. And what it emphasizes is flow of values, so a constant stream of tickets. So there's no sprints, there's continuous flow of value, and like Scrum, it emphasizes that all the work is visible all the time on the so-called Kanban board, where you've got columns you have to do in progress done. And the emphasis, you have work in progress limits. So you limit the number of tickets that can be in progress, so you stop it piling up, because anything piling up is a waste, because you're doing work that's not getting delivered to the end, while you could be doing work on a ticket to deliver it. Next is Scrumban. I'm not actually going to go into details. I'm listing it here because it's as the name says, it's something between Scrum and Kanban. But funny enough, it's actually much more complex than either Scrum or Kanban. I'm listing here because it's maybe interesting to look up. I haven't actually worked with it directly, but it found. I think it found a lot of use on very, very large projects where there are many separate teams that need to collaborate often, and that projects that have a very long defined backlog of things that need to be satisfied. Next one is extreme programming. Extreme programming is very similar to Scrum in the sense that it has sprints where you take tickets. There are some subtle differences with Scrum. But I'm listing it here because, unlike Scrum doesn't actually prescribe software development practices. Extreme programming prescribes very specific software development practices. Practices like test-driven development and pair programming and many others. And it's very, very useful to study, especially for developers, to study extreme programming, to read about it, because the practices in there, pretty much all of them can be used with almost any other Agile methodology. So you can actually, teams working with different Agile methodologies regularly take Scrum practices and just use them because they're useful on their own. There are many other Agile methodologies, but I don't actually know anything about them, so they're not. I'm not listing them. And I want to end with this slide. I want to talk about the importance of culture. Work culture and company culture. Quite often you might hear about people trying to implement an Agile methodology and then getting either very small improvement or actually being worse off, getting no improvement, and then declaring that Agile just doesn't work. And in most of the cases, the root cause is the culture. And one of the most important things is the sense that everyone is together in this. So if you got two developers, for example, Scrum has a daily stand-up. Actually, most of the Agile methodologies have a daily stand-up, a very short meeting where you tell what you did, what you're going to do, and what are your blockers. And the actual purpose of the daily stand-up is to hear where your colleagues are blocked and figure out if you can help them unblock. If you can actually, it might be more important that you drop your work and then you help them finish their work, because the team is all together. If I finish my work, I'm done, and Steve hasn't finished his because, you know, he's so damn slow. It doesn't matter that I finished mine. The project is not going forward. It would actually be better if I drop my work and help him finish that. And an important factor there is that there is a shared success, that everyone needs to understand that the incentives in the company, they cannot be individual. They have to be team to make the team culture stick. One really radical example is if the only way a boss can help the project move along is by getting coffee to the developers, then the boss should go and cook some coffee and bring it to the developers, because that is the biggest impact he at that moment, at that precise moment, can have on the project. There is a concept in Agile of chicken versus pig. It's sometimes used in literature, and it comes from an anecdote where a chicken and a pig are walking down the street, and the chicken says, "Hey pig, let's open a restaurant." And the pig says, "Why not? What's it going to be called? Ham and eggs." And the pig says, "Sorry, you would be, I'm not interested. You would be only involved, but I would be committed." And the moral in Agile is that every team member should be a pig. You should be committed. Your professional success is linked to the project that you're currently working on. People on the sidelines, users giving you feedback, testers or something like that, they are chickens. They are involved, but they are not really committed. But every team member needs to be a pig. And the most strongest way to get people to become pigs is to show them the value of the work they're doing. So to see exactly how the value is being delivered. And that is also why OAuth Agile methodologies put a lot of emphasis on putting developers in touch with customers and people benefiting from their work and showing working software often, because then you can see the impact that you're making on other people's lives, which is an extremely strong motivator. That's it. Thank you.
So we have about 4 minutes for questions. So. Does anyone have any questions? I, of course, have one. You mentioned pair programming. I'm not sure everyone's familiar with that. What is pair programming?
So the pair programming is the concept where two developers sit down at one computer. One is typing, and the other is sort of guiding. So they're discussing the problem together, and they're working on the problem together, where one is they're checking each other, and the keyboard is supposed to go back and forth. So one developer is typing, and then he gets stuck. He goes, "Oh, I don't give me the keyboard." Yeah, and then he's saying, "Oh no, you made a mistake here, go back." And in a lot of experiments, it has actually, people have found that two developers working like that together are actually producing more with higher quality than if they were working separately in parallel. And it's because the mistakes are often caught on the spot in the very second that the mistake is made, because the other person sees it. Try it. It's quite amazing. It can work in various occasions. If one person is much more experienced, then it's more like a mentoring exercise. If two people are roughly on the same level, then it's a sharing exercise where you can also improve. You can get what you're missing from the other person.
Any other questions?
Yeah. From your experience, what are some of the common pitfalls of Agile, or maybe problems and something like that?
It's really, I think, is the stuff on the last slide. Quite often is that people within Agile, people don't care. They say, "Oh, I did my work." People don't care about understanding the customers. So they're, "Oh, why did you implement that? That's what said it in the ticket." Yeah, well, why did it say that in the ticket? And when they try and understand that, instead of just following a specification or a process, developers quite often find problems in the original ticket. So instead of implementing, if they go back, they will find out the right thing to do. And that's where a lot of speed ups come. So a lot of speed up in properly implemented Agile comes from not developing something that you shouldn't be developing at all. So if you're, before in Waterfall, there was a study that they did like in the 70s, where they found that about 60% of the software created goes completely unused. So if you can remove that, that's a huge speed up. And the other thing is collaboration, that's real understanding. Retrospectives can get very, very, people get it very badly, because you need a culture where you can tell somebody honestly what was the problem? If you can honestly discuss, you said, oh, we messed up here, it was because of this, you were distracted, but you do it in a way not to blame, but to figure out how you're going to fix it, then every 2 weeks you have a very big improvement. So instead of just going cruising along, you know, we did this for years, every 2 weeks you're actually sitting down, you're taking a very honest and a very critical look at what you're doing, where you're failing, and what you need to do to improve it. And sprint after sprint, every 2 weeks, week after week, it adds up to really a lot. And quite often people just hold back in retrospectives. So definitely you should not hold back, you need to. Yeah. And the lead and the Scrum Master needs to really lead by example, by making themselves vulnerable, by just saying, oh, I completely dropped the ball there, this happened, I messed up, let's see how we can avoid it. I don't do this in the future.
Are there any exact metrics or something that you would use or not use Agile before the project so you can decide, like, number of people?
No, we use Agile.
Okay. Is there any
just
situation?
Which one might fit you? It's just a question.
I don't know, like 10,000 people in a team. Would you use Agile?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. It's a matter of exactly
a 20-year-long project.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, but are there any exact metrics that you would say?
There are some things where I've seen. I have the most experience with Scrum and Kanban. And Scrum works really well for agency type work. So when you've got demonstrations to the client and there is a fixed budget and you want to deliver the maximum value for the budget that they have, Scrum works really well because you see the clients at regular intervals because they have their jobs. And in my company, we have internal clients. We used to use Scrum, but it didn't work so well because we had constant contact with them, and that because they were also thinking, they had good suggestions all the time. And it's kind of destructive to Scrum to break the sprint. Things need to wait again to sprint. So we switched to Kanban for a continuous flow where we're pulling from top of the backlog, but they can reorder the backlog at any time. The only thing they're not allowed to do, they're not allowed to interrupt in progress tickets. So for internal clients where we have constant contact, Kanban work better, but for agency type work with external customers, I think Scrum works better.
That's all the time we have for questions.
So I just have one more short question. So we're talking about the development all the time. What when you have diverse set of teams, like content writers, digital designers, and you have a more diverse project, does it work? Yeah, but you're working on the same project. So it's still all the rules apply, right, to all the teams.
Yeah, it's a whole other topic. I didn't want to touch on that. Really, Agile prescribes cross-functional teams. So you would have, content writer would not be a separate team. He would sit next to the developer. Designer would sit, ideally, next to the content writer or the developer. So they're all working on one product. They're not, and they're all integrating all the time. So when a developer is working, if he can just ping the content writer saying something, this text doesn't match, then that's a really great efficiency boost. So cross-functional teams is, most Agile methodologies prescribe cross-functional teams.
So we'll all be across the street, of course, so if you see Radan, please ask him any more questions. It's also International Women's Day, so thanks ladies for being here.